I think it was Sir Francis Bacon said, in order to control nature, you must obey nature. And that's, in a sense, understand its essence, its nature, and then work with it, coexist with it. And he had basically the right idea.
The Sacramento River is the river of national significance in terms of wildlife and the habitat it provides. It's a national treasure. It's the lifeblood of the state, but it's its own lifeblood. Without the river and the water that winds its way through the valley, you would have a desert. You wouldn't have the microclimates and the other things that create the habitat for everything else to exist here.
My story of connecting with water and rivers, I think, really is a story about people. It's a mix of the natural dynamics of the river, then there's the geology, which expresses itself most importantly in the bank material for me. Then, of course, there's people and how people have restrained the river in certain areas and not restrained the river in certain areas. And the mixture of those is another kind of mystery. Right in the middle of the area that I've been thinking about closely, as a sort of a way to look at some small piece closely so that we can understand the way the whole thing works better. A great scientist that I know who studies rivers talked about patterns that we see in river processes occurring at different spatial octaves.
Inherent in the nature of water is a certain kind of movement, a certain pattern of movement. And when I'm talking about that, I'm not trying to be poetic, but I'm talking as a physicist. If you take water and let it do its own thing, it's going to wind. It's not going to go straight. In rivers, we call that meandering. In fact, if you take a little tiny bit of water and you let it loose on a pane of glass, it's not going to go straight. It's going to wander in that same pattern that meanders do.
Amount of power that it has to fulfill that form. It's almost like the form is, it's inherent to it.
Well, we have this Mediterranean climate and this river moving down through a corridor on the valley floor, and it's creating this gallery forest in the wake of its movement, and beyond that you have the valley oak forest and so forth. The essential element, the physical dynamic process that drives the creation of the forest, the creation of the many different habitats that occur along this river that support this whole bounty of wildlife, is meandering. It's movement on a landscape scale of the river across the floodplain as the channel cuts a new area and, in essence, creates new soil. Primary succession on a new surface. It occurs three places on Earth. You've got volcanoes, you've got glaciers, and you've got alluvial rivers. Primary new soil, new surfaces that are fresh places where it's species that are adapted to growing with ample quantities of water and without competition, grow in these incredibly productive gallery forests. These are absolutely unique systems. This doesn't happen anywhere else on the face of the earth, as far as I know.
The way that everyone has to do conservation out here, especially large-scale conservation strategies, is you have to incorporate the concerns of the local community, their interests, and try and meet as many of those needs as you can with some of your conservation strategies, along with trying to create habitat for a species of concern.
conditions have to be such that the forest can perpetuate itself. In this case, that takes about 30,000 acres. And that's what studies, models that Eric produces and others allow us to make those kinds of planning constructs and planning predictions.
Eric's model is a key planning tool for us because Eric can basically tell us, okay, if we place bank protection here or take bank protection out in this part of the model, this is kind of what we can expect to happen.
It was shown to me how the trees can go from little tiny baby trees close to the water to a little bit older, to a little bit older, to, you know, a more aged forest back there. And then I realized, of course, that's the extension of the expression of those forces that I knew fairly well, of a river moving towards the bendy side, you know. The river tends to move in that direction. And of course, on the other side, it builds, a bar builds and builds out. And here, all of a sudden, was a whole other system of life that mimicked the same energy, or was the same energy in a different expression. In the Second World War, you had the Army Corps of Engineers that were doing a lot of hard work. They were building bridges, they were building roads, they were making it possible for people to get into places and do what they needed to do. And when the war ended, you had an enormous army of engineers who were very skilled and needed things to do. And one way of saying it is they then turned and waged war on the rivers.
There was this, I don't know if you call it philosophical or societal point of view, where you could control nature. And in some places and to some extent, and if you're willing to, you know, put out the resources, you can do that, but it always comes at a cost.
Bank protection is our effort to actually stabilize the movement of the bank. And so on the Sacramento, almost all the effective bank stabilization is rock. It is reasonably effective in the short term, although ultimately, even if you have a very stable rock bank, it needs to be maintained over time.
In a river system where you have a river that floods, and then we don't allow the river to flood anymore. And because the river doesn't flood, it loses the capacity to withstand floods. And then when you eventually get that flood that's going to occur, and it will occur, it's a catastrophic flood. If you have a walnut orchard, it's not very convenient for that walnut orchard to be taken out by the river on a regular basis. These big investment orchard operations, you don't want them subject to being flooded out by the river every couple of years. We stabilize these systems and we want to extract from them the resources that we need, but we don't want them to change. It's that question of how do you slice up the pie. If you're going to preserve the productivity of these systems, the reality is the ecosystem has to get the first slice, or it doesn't exist. It doesn't maintain itself over time.
There's a lot of bank protection out there that is unjustified for any real reason, probably 60% of it. Without that movement, it's not life, it's dead. We talk about the river being stable, but when we say stable, we mean that it's a growing and moving system. We think of life as stable when we're healthy and we're eating and we're moving around. Well, the river is the same way.
Life is stable when it continues to move.
The fundamental question is not how do we control the river system. The fundamental question is how do we coexist with dynamic ecosystems? That's really the question of today. My job is not to take sides or positions or to favor one side or the other. My job is to, in essence, become the agent of change. How do we facilitate change back to a paradigm which actually functions, where we can have sustainability of those resources and values that people want to preserve?
On one level, people are doing the best they can with limited knowledge. And so that's what is exciting, if we can give people knowledge.
People have farms on the river, need to have places that won't fall into the river. People need to have pumps that are on the river that can be reliable and irrigate their fields. At the same time, the forests need to regenerate. Trees need to grow to provide habitat for animals. And there's this difficult mix of needs.
The great thing about the project is that the people believe in the river and its processes, and those the extension of those processes to those trees over there, those cottonwoods that we see, and that we could make a difference in allowing the river, encouraging the river to be what it can be potentially. Let the physics work for us. That's the idea.
If you understand the patterns and forces in water and you work with them,
there's much more order in letting it be free.